Section 1 of Reflections on the Rise, Progress, and Probable Consequences of the Present Contentions with the Colonies by a Freeholder. Reflections on the Rise, Progress, and Probable Consequences of the Present Contentions with the Colonies by a Freeholder by John Erskine. Introduction. Several late pamphlets composed with much art and ability, and recommended by many of the beauties of language, have painted in black and hateful colors the claims and conduct of the North Americans, and thereby have not a little inflamed the resentment of the mother country. The author of this small tract, though deeply sensible of the inferiority of his talents, yet confiding in the goodness of his cause, humbly attempts to soften that resentment. He represents, from the writings of colonists and of gentlemen who had the best access to know their sentiments, what concessions might have been procured from them by gentle measures, and what they complained of in those acts of Parliament which immediately occasioned their taking up arms. With this view, he prepared for the press the following reflections about a year ago. They would have been published the beginning of last session of Parliament, had it not been prevented by the negligence of one with whom the manuscript was entrusted. It was not till after many months that he recovered the manuscript. Want of leisure and very imperfect and doubtful information as to the late facts and reasonings have permitted him to make no important addition unless a paragraph occasioned by the pamphlet entitled Common Sense. Still, he flatters himself that this publication, though late, is not unseasonable. He wishes to convince his fellow freeholders, especially such of them who have seats in Parliament, that if the success of the British arms shall put it in our power to prescribe to our colonies conditions of peace, it will be our duty, our honor, and our interest, by a generous use of victory, to regain the lost affection of our old friends, and to extinguish in them every desire of becoming independent on Great Britain. 18th October, 1776. End of Section 1.
Section 1 of Reflections on the Rise, Progress, and Probable Consequences of the Present Contentions with the Colonies by a Freeholder. Reflections on the Rise, Progress, and Probable Consequences of the Present Contentions with the Colonies by a Freeholder, by John Erskine. Reflections 1 to 3. 1. Had authority determined me which side to take in the important question, how the mother country ought to conduct herself towards the colonies, I would have embraced these sentiments in favors of administration, which happened to be popular and fashionable with the greater part of my neighbors, my nearest relations, my most intimate friends, and the gentlemen with whom I generally think and act in other matters. But no authority, however respectable, can be pled against reason. No names or numbers will warrant my ascribing justice or wisdom to measures in which my understanding thinks it discerns the reverse. A fair state of the grounds of my opinion will satisfy the impartial that I have not formed it rashly, and may furnish many of my countrymen, who, with to judge candidly, with some not unuseful information, scattered in books, pamphlets, and periodical publications, which they have not opportunity or leisure to peruse, as to the sentiments of the colonists, their manner of pleading their own cause, and the regard due to some of their pleas. 2. One chief circumstance that hath reconciled a great part of the nation to war with the colonies is an apprehension that there was a general desire in them of independence on the mother country. Their extensive territory, wholesome and temperate climate, luxuriant and fertile soil, rapid population, commodious ports, and variety of products, united many of their friends and enemies in the idea that North America would one day become the seat of a flourishing empire. It is not improbable that, in some future period, this would have happened, and artful designing men found it no difficult task to excite her cherished suspicions that the colonies were already aiming at this, and that checking their growth and abridging their liberties was the only method of defeating their schemes. But an able writer, no way biased in favor of the colony claims, and who had the best advantage for knowing facts, hath borne ample testimony that the colonists in general were loyal to their sovereign, well affected to the mother country, zealous for her prosperity, and far from harboring any rebellious designs against the just rights of government. Their merchants are, and ever must be, in a great measure allied with these of Britain. Their very support consists in this alliance, and nothing but false policy here can break it. Footnote: Pownell's Administration of the Colonies, 4th edition, London, 1768, page 40, and dedication, page 6 and 8. End of footnote. Their political and religious principles are incompatible with submitting to the government or asking the protection of France or Spain. No one colony could by itself shake off dependence on the mother country, and no two had any common majesty or principle of association, till the attempting to connect them to us by power connected them to one another in policy. Before this, their different charters, forms of governments, manners and customs, religious sentiments, jarring claims and interests, and the rivalship and jealousy arising from all these, prevented any such union among them, one with another, as all of them had with the mother country. Footnote: Pownell's Administration, pages 35, 38, 93. End of footnote. That there might be amongst them men of republican principles, or men ambitious to be the heads of a new kingdom or commonwealth, is no unnatural supposition. But had Britain left them in the happy situation in which they were before the Stamp Act, these would have been few in number, and could never have persuaded 12 provinces to revolt from a government under which they felt themselves easy and secure. In answer to this, it may be urged that a pamphlet entitled Common Sense, published in Philadelphia the beginning of this year, argues the necessity of the colonies declaring themselves independent of Britain. I reply, that pamphlet has been refuted by other writers in Philadelphia under the signatures of Candidus, Rationalis, and Cato. The following extract from Cato's second letter to the people of Philadelphia, 11th March 1776, will, I hope, be acceptable to some of my readers. Nor have many weeks yet elapsed since the first open proposition for independence was published to the world. By what men of consequence this scheme is supported, or whether by any, may possibly be the subject of future inquiry. Certainly it has no countenance from the Congress, to whose sentiments we look up with reverence. On the contrary, it is directly repugnant to every declaration of that respectable body. It would be needless to quote particular passages in proof of this, as they are to be met with in almost every page of their proceedings. I will refer to a few only, viz., their resolves, March 5, 1775, their declaration, July 6, their address to the King, July 8, their letter to the Lord Mayor of London, and more especially, their declaration for a fast, 12th June, in which, with the deepest marks of sincerity, they call upon all America to join with them in addressing the great governor of the world, humbly beseeching him to avert the desolating judgments with which we are threatened, to bless our grateful sovereign, etc., that so America may soon behold the redress of her many grievances, the restoration of her invaded rights, and reconciliation with the parent state, on terms constitutional and honorable to both. Will anyone be so hardy as to say that either the appointment or observation of this solemn day was a mere mockery of heaven and earth? I trust not. I might add the sentiments of our own representatives in assembly, expressed in the instructions to their delegates, the sentiments of Maryland in similar instructions, the resolves of New Jersey and New Hampshire, nor shall the much injured province of Massachusetts Bay be left out of the catalogue, whose provincial Congress, while yet bleeding with the wounds received at Lexington, thus addressed the inhabitants of Great Britain. These are marks of ministerial vengeance against this colony, but they have not yet detached us from our royal sovereign, etc., trusting that in a constitutional connection with the mother country, we shall soon be a free and happy people. Some future opportunity, I doubt not, to make it appear that independence is not the cause in which America is now engaged, and is only the idol of those who with to subvert all order among us and rise on the ruins of their country. Late events do not prove what the colonies originally intended, but what advantages artful men have gained to mislead them from the conduct of administration. 3. But are not the American claims of exemption from parliamentary taxation a virtue of renouncing subjection to the king and dependence on the mother country? If the Americans have the exclusive right of taxing themselves, what power is to remain in the supreme legislature? May the British Parliament tell them how much they shall contribute? If the sum may be prescribed, they will return few thanks for the power of raising it. Footnote: surely there is no compliment to Lord North's conciliatory motion. End of footnote. If they are at liberty to grant or to deny, they are no longer subjects. Footnote: taxation, no tyranny. Third edition, page 52. End of footnote. In sovereignty, there are no gradations. There may be limited monarchy, but there can be no limited government. There must in every society be some power or other from which there is no appeal, which admits no restriction, which pervades the whole mass of the community, enacts laws or repeals them, erects or annuls judicatures, extends or contracts privileges, exempt itself from question or control. From this all legal rights are emanations, which, whether equitably or not, may be legally recalled. The charter by which provincial governments are constituted may be always legally, and where it is either inconvenient in its nature or misapplied in its use, may be equitably repealed. Could a gentleman of good sense.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.